Hi, I'm Abram Hindle from the University of Alberta.
Hi, I'm Prem Devanbu from UC Davis.
Hi, I'm Earl T. Barr of University College London.
Okay, I'm going to start with a couple of examples that'll hopefully pique your interest. First, let me ask you, do these two chord fragments above mean the same to you? Most of you would probably say yes, it's just a factorial function. There's nothing in these fragments of code that convey any other intention. Okay, let me show you one more. How about these two? Do they mean the same thing? On the one hand, from a purely computational perspective, they're exactly the same. But I suspect many of you would still say, no, they're not the same. For those of you who are in doubt, let me ask you this. Let me give you a perceptual association test kind of thing and ask you, which picture on the right would you associate with which function on the left? Find the richest? Find the heaviest? I don't think any of you would really hesitate, right? Right? So what's my point here? The point here is that code has two audiences. One audience is the machines on which the code must run correctly, and the other audience is the humans who must understand it to maintain it and extend it. Therefore, for this reason, because of these two audiences, human programmers strive to write code that is not only correct, but also works for humans. Right. Okay, so let's put a pin on this two-channel thing that I got going on in the previous slide, and we can come back to it later. Turning back to naturalness, let me spend a few minutes talking about the idea for this paper that we wrote 10 years ago, for which we're now receiving this MIP award. Thanks again to the selection committee for picking this paper. So the idea we talked about 10 years ago was that the way we humans use language to talk and to write has evolved naturally to meet human needs to communicate, for food, to find food, to care for our young, to find mates, and so on. So our argument, again, 10 years ago, was that the way we humans code has also evolved to meet human needs rather than just run on computers. So what is this naturalness and where does this arise? So first, for natural language. Human beings communicate using natural language. However, our attempts to communicate are stymied by distractions. To overcome these obstacles, we often express ourselves in ways that'll work even if our intended audience is distracted. So natural languages, as they're used, are redundant. They're repetitive, predictable, and highly amenable to statistical modeling. This is great because this enables things like speech recognition, translation, and so on that make our lives much easier. Code, on the other hand, has formal semantics, which are faithfully followed by computers. So if a tiger were to wander the hallways of a server farm, it's going to just ignore it and do what we tell it to do faithfully. On the other hand, human beings don't interpret the code formally. They are subject to all sorts of distractions. And so thus, code has two channels that are not exactly the same. One of them is formal and not subject to noise. The other one is. So from this comes about the naturalness of code. Even though code has formal semantics, it is subject to noise when humans read it. So like natural language, the way we humans write code is repetitive, predictable, and amenable to statistical modeling. In a recent paper, for example, we found that even though these two ways of incrementing i equals 1 plus 1, 1 plus i, and i equals i plus 1 are exactly the same, the one on the left is much more preferred and, in fact, is easier to understand. So that's the naturalness of code. So why does this matter? Tools. So let's think about the way people normally bring tools. Some developer has a great idea for a tool, so they build it, and then they can run the tool on source code and produce output. So maybe it's going to check for defects, maybe it's going to check coding standards, maybe it's going to produce a UML diagram. Once a developer builds the code, they can test it and use it. Often, however, such tools make various approximations and design trade-offs because of scale, computational complexity, and such. These approximations and trade-offs mean that in practice, the performance of these tools is often sub-ideal, sometimes too conservative, sometimes too adventurous. So is there a systematic, principled way to build a tool so it's most likely to work on most code? That's where naturalness comes in. So we start with a large corpus of code, which essentially has latent within it a lot of knowledge about how to make tools work better on real code. So because of naturalness, we can estimate statistical models over these large corpora. And this model probabilistic model can help our tools work better. Because we have very, very large corpora, we can make the model very good indeed. So how does this probabilistic model help the tool? Well, essentially, these models, when built into implemented tools, can help us do things like classification, ranking, prioritizing search, et cetera, much better. So a little more specifics on what kinds of things are possible, right, in our papers reported over the years, right? So there's various kinds of probabilistic models one can estimate. I won't talk about all of these, but you can use it to check code. You can use it to recover names. You can use it for gradual typing. You can use it for code suggestion, which is what is built into Copilot. You can do code summaries. You can do retrieval of code. You can assign people to tasks. Lots of opportunities for applications. There are almost 1,000 papers in the area, if not more. There are several startups, all the major software companies or groups that work on this. So it's a very active and exciting area, and I invite you to join us.
Hi, I'm here as Abram Hindle to talk about the work that I did at UC Davis with Prem Devanbu, Zhendong Su, Mark Gabel, and Earl Barr, especially with other lab colleagues such as Foyger Rahman and Daryl Posnett. So I joined UC Davis at the start of this project. Prem basically said, let's do something along the lines of NLP applied to source code. I think he was interested in my latent Dirichlet allocation topic analysis work that I'd been doing at the time, as well as other artifact analysis. So we started off by basically going to Crepeville, a crepe restaurant near campus, at least once a week, and having meetings or reading group sessions about the Manning book, Foundations of Statistical NLP. In that, I don't know if we really got much further past chapter 3. We kind of really latched on to n-gram models. We weren't too interested in the other tree stuff and the tagging, but the n-gram models seemed really neat. So we were trying out the n-gram models, and the results weren't making a lot of sense because it turned out that there was a lot of unseen vocabulary and a lot of unknowns. So in a basic n-gram model without smoothing, you're going to basically bottom out on your probability. You're going to end up dividing by zero because you haven't seen something. So what we had to do is we had to investigate smoothing. So we started off with like just the good Turing smoothing, just like a plus one, or just pretending we saw it once. And we were finding that wasn't really working that great. So we looked into other n-gram models, and we found MITLM, which was a G4tran / C++ based implementation that was really fast. Use this hashing mechanism, these hash chains that worked really great, and it worked for what we needed to do, and I could modify it enough such that I could make it updatable, so I could send it new information and it could update the counts in the chains such that it could do estimation. Even better, it came with a really nice smoothing algorithm, modified Nezer-Ney. Once we got that working, I jammed that all into Emacs because we basically daemonized MITLM, and it had a Perl script that could basically query it. So once it was up, you could basically query from Emacs based on your current file what you could co-complete, and everything that you had sent to it to co-complete, it could learn off of. We knew this wasn't really going to fly for something like ICSE, so we had to move from, you know, fun languages like Perl to more boring languages like Java. So we employed Eclipse, its co-completion framework, and we set the n-gram model on Java for the most part. But we could do just about any other language. So in the paper, there's evaluations on C and other kinds of things. But we wanted to compare, at least for code completion, against a mature code completer. So we used the code completer in Eclipse at the time, which was very popular. So what I had to do for the final evaluation that compared against Eclipse is I had to force Eclipse to code complete way over 30,000 times. So I had 10 VMs on Amazon AWS. They were running concurrently, and I had VNCs open, making sure that Eclipse wasn't dying on me, because it always would. Eclipse was never meant to code complete 30,000 times a second. Eventually, we got down to it, and by the time that ICSME rolled around, we were finishing up our changes to the paper, and we had an excellent result. essentially ngram models modeled source code really well. They dealt with source code in an intuitive way using surprise and perplexity and cross entropy. I would take this work and I would kind of push it into the IR realm and contextual realms. So it was a kind of a different direction. But my students, Hazel Campbell and Eddie Antonio Santos, extended the work quite greatly. They noticed that the surprise mechanism of the ngram model was quite useful, and you could use that for identifying where syntax errors were, better than a parser could, because a parser had formal rules that would oftentimes kind of blame things just where it broke, not necessarily where the issue was. So what occurred was essentially Hazel wrote an error detector and an error locator for syntax errors, and it didn't need parsable source code. Eddie Antonio Santos extended that and used that to basically code repair the syntax errors. So you have unparsable source code, you could use the ngram model or an LSTM model to code repair. So they both work very hard at that. I am now currently applying these same naturalness ideas to languages that don't seem to be very language-like. Graph-based languages, visual languages, languages used in engineering, used in music, and used to teaching programming. These visual languages are often data flow-driven, yet the current analysis we've done on their code clones and their repetitiveness shows that indeed, these visual languages are quite natural. So that's where the next bit of my focus is going to be, in the area of naturalness. And I thank everyone involved. It was a really great experience.
Since working on the naturalness paper, I have had the good fortune to enjoy nature hikes with many collaborators and enthusiastic naturalists. I thank each of them. Prem and Abram have talked about where we've been. I'm going to tell you about one direction we're headed. Code has two audiences, the machine that executes it and the developer who must understand it. To satisfy both audiences, programmers try to write code that is both correct and easy to maintain. These twin audiences and two goals give rise to two channels. The algorithmic channel carries all the statements that the code needs in order to run correctly. The natural language channel carries the cues like names and formatting decisions that help programmers understand the code. These two channels share tokens and are intertwined. Example dual or cross-channel interactions include names, like function names, layout, and ordering decisions. And why? Because developers use both channels. Some of these interactions form constraints. For example, renaming a function that actually computes the sieve of Eratosthenes like this one does to Josephus would be confusing and slow down understanding the method. To explain how dual channel constraints arise, we turn to Shannon's noisy channel model as adopted in psycholinguistics. To resist noise, the speaker chooses an encoding for the intended message that maximizes the probability that the listener receives the intended message. In the context of code, the intended message is the specification. And again, we have two audiences. In the development setting, the programmer chooses an encoding, specifically code, to maximize the probability that M equals M prime, that both audiences get the intended message given the code. Because the code is dual channel, programmers prefer encodings where the channels synergize rather than antagonize. Dual channel constraints arise from this preference. The two channels are asymmetric. The machine mostly ignores the natural channel. For instance, the machine ignores identifier names up to alpha renaming. If we end this asymmetry, the machine can help the developer understand the code better and faster. Dual channel analysis aims to do just that. This theory was published in NIR 2020. It has three consequences. It offers a new angle on age-old questions in linguistics. Consider the question, why do people choose to say things the way they do? In English, bread and butter is preferred to butter and bread. If someone says butter and bread, are they joking or is it a mistake? It's hard to know because in natural language, reordering almost always changes the meaning and mistakes can be intended and meaningful. In code, expressions like I plus one and one plus I are semantically equivalent. Code allows us to separate meaning and order. Casey, Prem, and Emily conducted an elegant experiment to do just that. They correlated surprisal with mental computation. And they found that developers prefer less surprising code and comprehend it faster. When the two channels are in sync, using both provides more training data. For the usual array of software engineering tasks, the two channels can fall out of sync. Code can do something other than what it says it does, like save your file and send your banking details to evil.com, a function that computes the sieve of Erasthenes can be misnamed, as we saw earlier. Comments can also lose any connection at all to the code they originally commented. Dual channel analysis can detect and report such inconsistencies. Thank you.